I just want to start by thanking Design Indaba for inviting us here today. It's a real privilege to be here in this fine city. And as you can see from this diagram, we come from quite different backgrounds. And it's this kind of collaborative approach which enables us to produce the work that we're going to talk about today. But it's not just us three. There's a team of 20 people back in the UK. But there's no two people with the same background or education. I think for successful kind of collaborative practices to work, I think the skill set needs to be diverse so that the skills complement each other. So here's a picture of our studio, some of the team members. We have a kind of small workshop. We make stuff, very hands-on, prototyping. And it's a, yeah, it's a creative space. It's really nice there. So I've started with this image. It's called An Experiment on a Bird in the Air Pump by Joseph Wright Dobie. And I've started with this image because there's a lot of things that resonate with the work that UVA produce in this image here. You've got the performance from the scientists. You've got all the curiosity surrounding technology and experimentation. And then you've got the atmosphere. You know, it's an incredibly atmospheric picture because of the painting technique of light. But it's the emotive quality of this piece that I want to draw attention to. You know, it's when you look at the faces on the people, it really kind of pulls you into the picture. And this emotional response is something that we try to design for. So what we're going to do, we're going to talk about the journey of UVA. We're 10 years old now. So we're just going to quickly go through where we started, where we're working at now, and what we're going to be doing in the future. So I'm going to hand over to Chris now. Thank you.
All right, cheers, Matt. As Matt says, we've got a very wide and diverse range of skills, but really, we cut our teeth in the area of what you might call live performance or designing for the stage. And we formed our company together, the three of us, working with a band called Massive Attack. And we've now been designing stage sets for them for the last 6-7 years. Something about designing for the stage is about the performance. It's about the emotion. It's about the excitement. It's about the buzz of being there at a gig with people. It's a shared experience. And these kind of shared experiences that we try and create for bands also come over into our later work, and Ash is going to talk about that later. The stage is an interesting place. When you go into a gig, you're always looking forwards. You're looking at that object on the stage. It's almost an object of admiration. It's something that you aspire to. All of us as kids want to be guitar players or dance around our bedrooms with our tennis rackets. So going to see a gig is always something that's really exciting for all of us. And for us, it's really an important space, and it's where we really start to understand our kind of work. With Massive Attack, we got a very interesting brief to design a stage set which included a large video screen, but that video screen was not to have any video on it. It was all about real-time information, more like a data display board than a video screen. The idea was that this was something that was live and that really, really could change and evolve from one gig to the next. It's not just about what you put on the stage. When you're designing for a stage, you're talking about the performers themselves. So the screen elements and the lighting elements and the performers themselves work in orchestration with each other. And it's these things in combination that create such a powerful spectacle. For us, we always like to design our own tools. And this real-time exploration, delivering text information, delivering information onto the screen, was only made possible by creating our own software elements. This is a picture of a very early and fairly rare picture of an early bit of software we created for Massive Attack called Mosquito. It's a MIDI-driven, beat-driven text generator. But behind the scenes, you could change the text content every day so that the same production would happen one day after the next, but the content would be different. Developing tools is something that's really key to our work practice at UVA, and we create all of our own tools to move our productions forward. Massive Attack have a political opinion. And for us, the screen, and for the band, was a means of communication for them. It was a canvas that they could update fully daily. There were slogans, bits of news, information, real-time information, demographics. And all of this information could be replayed and made it very personal and immediate for those people. And in fact, there was a few moments where that information created such a stir. Nash has a little story about that.
I was actually at a gig in Milan working on this show. And what we do every day is we talk to a translator and they'd tell us what was current, what the news was, what people were talking about. And we'd put that up on the screen in a particular track. In Milan that weekend, there was a furor because there was this young kid who'd been arrested by the police and had died in custody. And there was a cover-up going on and everyone was talking about it. It was in all the papers. At the top of this song, we put up Justice for this, the name of this kid. And there was literally a riot in the auditorium. The police came in, they tried to stop the gig. So it can actually be a very, very powerful tool for connecting with your audience.
Yeah, and I think there was another time when we put the football scores up. Porto FC beat Liverpool 4-0. Fortunately, we weren't in Liverpool when that score came around. So. Obviously, the power of text is very important. We all see words every day. We read them in newspapers, see them on the news, scrolling along the bottom. So this is a great opportunity for us to explore how one might design a stage set around a font. In fact, the later generations of the massive attack tools that we've been working on include a stage design which is designed entirely around a font. As you can see, these LED modules, as you can see on the left, have been designed able to carry this particular font that, that Matt and his design team put together. So this is a really unusual thing to think about when you're designing for a stage, just designing around the shape of a font or text. But it's not all about that, because when you're designing for stage, these elements have to tour. They have to go into the back of trucks. They have to go into airplanes. They have to load in and out of venues. So a lot of the work we do is very modular. And it's modular for the very reasons that you have to get these things into trucks, but also stages are different sizes. So you can design a stage set, but the next day it may have to be half the size. But it's an interesting concept when you think that you have to design for the spectacle of the performance and the production so we can all experience that in the gig. But at the same time, when you guys go and leave the gig, someone's got to pack it down and put it in a truck and move it to the next place. So it's all designed to be efficient and be able to move around as quickly as possible. The tools that we develop have been moving forwards over time. And in more recent massive attack tools, we're also controlling the lighting and the video. So all of these elements work together as a single canvas. I've got a quick movie we're going to show just to give you a taste of some of the massive attack tools that we've done. Really, really, you have to go and see the gig, and you may get an opportunity to see some people from Massive Attack this weekend. Who knows? Now, The thing is about designing for the stage is it's not all about one band. There's all sorts of different opportunities to design for bands, and there's all sorts of different lighting technologies one might use. And over the course of the years, we've also worked with U2, more recently Red Hot Chili Peppers, a New York band called Battles, and Jay-Z. In most of these cases, we're designing video content and stage design, but more recently, we've been concentrating on the sculptural form on the stage. And our main priority is just to create emotion and the spectacle when we're on the stage. And we've learned a lot of things from that. Some of the elements that you can see here are something that we've really learned just by doing things. It's been mainly an experiment. But these concepts, broadly speaking, we apply to a lot of the other work that we do. And I'm going to hand over to Ash, and he's going to talk to you about some of them.
All the work that we showed you there really kind of represents our roots, where we started. What it all has in common is there's a bunch of technology on a stage, and then there's this big, sharp dividing line, and then on the other side is you, the audience. And over time, we became interested in seeing what would happen if we could cross that line and dissolve that line and allow people to come onto stage. So this next body of work, I guess, really represents where we moved on to. I like this image just because it sort of really captures the feeling. People sitting around a fire, there's something very primal, very primitive about it. People sitting together, keeping warm in the dark that's all around them. And really what you have here, this is the first work that we created of this type where people could come up really close to it. Again, it's this idea of this shining light that's right in the middle that you can walk up close to. This is a piece called Monolith. We were asked to create this for a one-night-only experience. The total budget was £100. We borrowed the LED, we borrowed some speakers. And the idea was to create this sort of very simple, very modern, quite intimidating object that would contrast with this sort of beautiful, ornate environment that was around it. This is the garden in the middle of the V&A, the Victoria and Albert Museum. It was a very, very basic interaction. As you walked up to it, it would become more and more aggressive, sort of scream at you. And we expected that only a few people would actually want to get up close to it. But in fact, what happened was that we had crowds of people, I don't know if you can see that, who all sort of walked up to it and stood really close to it. So we had to push them back with barriers. Here's a little video of how it felt. So although that piece was kind of flawed in a way, it was a real hit with the public. Everyone loved it, and it led to us being commissioned by the V&A to produce a larger work in that same space, and the result was this piece here, which is one of the pieces that probably we're best known for. It's called Volume. And the idea was rather than having a single monolith, we had lots of them in a grid, and you could approach it from any side. Each of those is effectively an LED screen. It's a really thin one with a little speaker on the top. And we commissioned our friends Massive Attack to produce a 48-channel digital symphony. And each column would play its own part of the piece, but only when you walked up to it. This work's really interesting because when you're standing back from it and there's nobody in it, it's a sculpture. If it's so full of people that every column is playing a piece of music, then it's really a performance, it's just a piece of music. But yet when you have about 20 people inside, it becomes something completely different. This is an interesting shot just because it shows you the kind of work that goes into making a piece like that. A lot of complexity, a lot of hard work. Chris got pneumonia going under the stage in freezing water because it was in winter. I'll show you a piece of video to give you an idea of how it felt.
Thank you.
So we continue to be really interested in this idea of a performance piece where the act of going into it changes it in some way. Now this piece is really how this developed. This is a piece called Chorus. It's 8 swinging pendulums controlled by a computer. What's also interesting about this piece is the environment that you put it in completely changes the meaning of the work. So you put it in a warehouse, and it's a sort of industrial, quite scary, brutal sort of piece. You put it exactly the same piece in a cathedral, and it becomes a meditation on spirituality and things like that. It's an interesting piece also because it's a performer that's mechanical. So you have each pendulum has a light and a speaker in there. So all the elements of the music are actually moving back and forth. And depending on where you stand, you get a completely different experience. This is the first time we tried making things that moved, and we had a hell of a lot to learn because none of us were really very experienced. We tried magnets. Eventually, we settled on lawnmower motors to kick the pendulum back and forth. This is, I think, the first time we actually made it work. And we also wrote our own systems, again, as with our previous work. This was a complicated system to kick the pendulums into the right place. And I'll show you a bit of video of the piece itself to give you an idea. So that's another work that, like Volume, we take on tour around the world. People book it, and we put it on different places. It's been everywhere, like I said, from an opera house to an industrial warehouse to a cathedral. We're always looking for interesting locations. And as time has gone on, we've really become quite interested in this idea of scale, because when you work for a band, you work on these really big productions. People like U2, and so on and so forth, they're huge things. And the feeling that you get when you walk up to this massive machine is you know, it's quite awe-inspiring. And we're quite interested in that idea. So whenever we get a chance to make something big, we jump at it. And the next project I'm going to show you is one of the biggest we've done to date. This is a piece called Origin. It was loosely inspired by the idea of a machine that demands to be worshipped. So I don't know if you've seen 2001, where that monolith that sits there that the monkeys go crazy for. The idea was to produce something that made you feel the same way. It's something that was really awe-inspiring. But to do that with a fairly limited amount of technology. So we created this this cubic lattice. It's about 10 by 10 by 10 meters. We were commissioned to produce this just under the Brooklyn Bridge. You can see that there in the corner. It was placed in this amazing old tobacco warehouse, really old building with no ceiling. So from the outside, it looked incredible. It was like this spaceship had landed in the middle of this really old building. We built the whole thing in 5 days, again using our tools, you can see there in the corner. Very, very little sleep, so there was construction during the day. Any kind of weather changes would cause these things to fail, so people going up on cranes to fix them at all times. And then we let the people in. We had a lot of interest in from the public, because obviously the location was really stunning. What was so interesting about this piece was that, you know, you do lots of these installations and you think that you know how people are going to behave. And in fact, what this taught us is that you really never, ever know, because we expected that people would walk around and move around inside, and we had a camera positioned on them to see what they'd do and control the installation. And in fact, people just walked in and sort of sat down and lay down on the floor. So unfortunately, with this video, it doesn't have amazing sound, but just imagine lots of bass. It's a very, very powerful sound system. So this work is kind of the culmination of this phase of our work, but of course, we're now, of course, turning to the future, and Matt's going to talk to you about the next phase of our development as a practice. Mm-hmm. I'll just
meet, there you go. So, yeah, thanks, Ash. So most of the projects that we've talked about up until this point, well, all of them, in fact, they're temporary pieces, but we are, in fact, working on a number of permanent pieces, and this is a kind of new departure for us. And some of these works are inspired by nature, natural systems, natural phenomena. And this is a work called Canopy. It's a 90-meter long sculpture. Consists of 8,000 controllable light modules. And the idea for the piece came from a direct response to the environment. You can see the picture on the left there is downtown Toronto, where the work is situated. And when we went there for the first time, it was just concrete, right angles, and it was really kind of urban, and it didn't really have any kind of organic feel to it at all. So we thought, wouldn't it be nice to create a canopy of light which you could walk underneath and experience, a bit like walking through a forest. We also like the idea of the city being a kind of living organism, and how something technological can be considered organic, like the picture on the left here, which is a picture of a city taken from a satellite at night, and it looks like an organism in a way. And when you zoom into a leaf and you see all the cell structures building, they're like little machines collaborating. And even though Canopy is a light sculpture, it's important that it works in the daytime. And the interesting thing about Canopy is that it has all these reflective surfaces. So when you walk underneath it, it animates naturally. And then at nighttime, the artificial light comes into play. And this was a departure for us. Like I said, we worked on temporary projects before this. And this has to last for 50 years. And you know, Toronto has very, very extreme weather conditions. In the winter, it gets down to minus 40. There's lots of snow, so you've got wind speed, snow load, and it gets very hot and humid in the summer. So we went through quite a painful process of learning about materialities, finding the right materials to use. And to get this organic feeling of for the composition, we actually wrote this script. We write tools like this quite often to help feed into the design process. And what you can see here is a sequence of images. What this script allows you to do is draw one gesture by hand, in the red line, and then you can grow the module composition through code. I'll just show you a little bit of a movie. So another project inspired by nature was a project called High Arctic. In 2010, we won a competition to design a new exhibition for the National Maritime Museum in London. A part of that competition involved a trip going to the Arctic on a sailing boat, but there was only one place, so there was a fair bit of heated debate who should go. I won. And here's some pictures I took. We went along with a charity called Cape Farewell and a group of climate scientists, and their idea is to kind of put scientists and artists together and experience climate change firsthand, and then bring that experience back to wherever you live and create a work from that experience. this is me on a glacier looking down a crevice, and we, you know, I took thousands of beautiful pictures. It's just awe-inspiring landscape. But when I was on this glacier, climate scientist said to me, you know, when your child is your age, this isn't going to be here, you know, absolutely certain. And in fact, all the glaciers in Svalbard will be gone in the next 50 years, and that just made me think, wow, this is, you know, there's a real sense of loss and sadness here. I mean, the ramifications of that for the rest of the world is going to be considerable. So it would have been all too easy to show these images of the landscape. I took thousands of pictures, hours of film, but we wanted to create something a bit more symbolic, really. We liked the idea of creating a monument to Arctic past, but set 100 years in the future. And I remember going to Japan and seeing these cemeteries, really angular, beautiful sculptures in a way. But what was also interesting is it kind of makes a landscape. So we took this idea and designed our own monument. And our design involves 3,000 separate monuments, each with the individual name of a glacier on Svalbard, which is going to disappear due to climate change. In between the physical sculpture were projected environments. And when the visitors arrived, they were given a torch, a UV torch. And this worked on two levels. It revealed all the names through the phosphorescent ink, very analog, but it also created hotspots for the interaction where they could mess with the environment. This is one of the pictures. So as I said, there's no kind of literal representations of the Arctic. Even though there's these kind of natural simulations, it's all very kind of digital looking in a way. And quite often with these large-scale projects, you know, you work for a huge amount of time before you actually build it, and you have to go through all sorts of processes to kind of get an idea for how it's going to work and feel. And we did have fun with Lego for about 2 months. Not very high tech, but it worked as a perfect kind of scale model technique. And this movie here shows our software that Chris and Ash have both talked about. We use it on all of our art projects as well. And it allows us to visualize the environment in 3D in real time before you actually go to set up the installation. But it's then just a case of plugging it in. It actually controls the installation as well. So what you can see here are the torch hotspots, and they're kind of breaking ice. And there's various different simulations of the natural environment. And what you do is you sit there and you play with the interaction and listen to a bunch of stories. And this is where Nick Drake come into it. He was on the boat with me. He's a poet and a writer. And Nick basically wrote about 50 stories. And these stories were all to do with man's relationship with the Arctic since the first explorer went there way back in 500 BC, Pythias the Greek. And it goes all the way 100 years into the future, where there's stories from not just humans, but polar bears and the ice itself. So what I'm going to do here is just give you, show you a quick movie to give you an idea of how it felt.
And now, the general synopsis. At 0048 hours, on the 31st of December, 2049, 4. Barents Sea, Beaufort Sea, Bering Sea, Laptev Sea, East Siberian Sea, Chukchi Sea, Greenland Sea, Sea of Okhotsk, Kara Sea, Baffin Bay, Arctic Basin, Canadian Archipelago, South, Severe Gale 9, to Violent Storm 11, Veering, Backing, Visibility Poor, Becoming Fog, New Ice, Frazzle Ice, Pancake Ice, Brash Ice, Grey Ice, White Ice, Leaping Ice, Fast Ice, Field Ice, Needle Ice, Candle Ice, Sea Ice. General synopsis. Going. Going. Melt. Thaw. Wane. Withdraw. Fade. Recede. Dwindle. Decline. Dissolve. Diminish. Expire. Perish. Disappear. Vanish. Requiem Aeternam. General synopsis. Severe. Imminent. Shipping lanes. Winter roads. Gas deposits. Undersea oil. Minerals. Diamonds. Palladium. Copper. Nickel. Platinum. Silver. Gold. Kyrie eleison. Sing now and raise the dead. Time for us to go. Sing now and raise the dead. Time for us to go. Extinguish all. Candles, oil lamps, tapers.
Okay, so yeah, going back to the beginning again about the emotive quality in our work, it's very important to us. We always document people's reactions, and quite often we judge the success of a project in how much you change the way that someone feels. So I think we're going to end there.